welcome to this course, the ABCs of Anaesthesia Bootcamp. And just a little bit about me. So I'm a consultant anaesthetist at Western Health. Obviously, I really enjoy teaching, like a lot of us, and a lot of you will hopefully in the future as well. I do a lot of simulation, in situ teaching in theatre, and a lot of online stuff, because that's really all the time we have during Zoom. During COVID, because there's not much else we can do, really. I started this course back in about 2012. In a much smaller way. I used to just give these morning tutorials at 7 a.m. and it's really just grown from there, because I think I'm trying to fill in this gap of giving a lot of practicality to introductory trainees outside of the usual stuff that they get taught, as well as the usual first part stuff that you know you seem to need to know very early on. A little bit about me and my resources. So a lot of you may already know the ABCs of Anaesthesia Facebook group is available. This course, you can always reach me at abcsofanaesthesia@gmail.com. I'm always able to get me any questions or any resources you'd like. And also run a small website called the Anaesthesia Collective. So www.anaesthesiacollective.com. And I'll just keep posting more things there. And if there's anything you guys want to contribute in the future, feel free to ask me as well. Just recently started this YouTube channel, and I'll just keep adding content. So yeah, please subscribe and ask for notifications so I can just get stuff out to you if you need. And also a couple of podcasts coming out soon, just with a couple of colleagues who are really good at this stuff as well. Actually, just wanted to try this. Would everyone just press their space bar now and just say hello? And I just want to see what that sounds like.
Hello.
Yo, yo, yo.
Hello.
Excellent.
Hello. Hey. Hello.
That's the sound of 100 hello. People saying hello. That's great. An obvious disclaimer, I'll give you lots of medical information here, but it's all general, okay? So obviously, I don't expect anyone will actually treat patients based on this information alone, but this is all general information. And if you're treating a patient, make sure you do that in consultation with your treating team and your boss. Now, this is something I definitely didn't have during my training, but I think I was lucky. So I think this is one of the hardest times, and I think what trainees go through now is far harder than what I went through, just with everything that's happening with COVID. And all the limitations on training positions, all that kind of stuff. But I just want you all to keep the perspective that you've already won at life. You know, the fact is you're a doctor living in Australia in 2020, and regardless of how bad 2020 is, you're still, you know, amongst the luckiest people who ever lived. And life has never actually been better for anyone ever in the history of time. So even if you fail at everything from here on, I just want you to remember that you're still all good. I say this because during my training every 2 years, really, really sadly, a colleague of mine committed suicide. And it was just this thing that happened every couple of years, and people didn't really think of it as it was just a tragedy, but it wasn't something that was, spoken about or really, you know, it wasn't something that was acknowledged in the same way it is now. So I just wanted to put that out there that, you know, it's never going to be that bad, and to keep things in perspective. And so if things are getting difficult, you know, make sure you have a GP, you know, have a friend to talk to, keep your connections and your contacts, your family and friends are the most important things throughout your life and career. I hate saying this because I was always so focused on career, but career should always come second to that thing, in my opinion. And there's lots of resources out there. This final book that I've just put up there, Also Human, really chilling and very, very poignant, because I essentially all the stories there are so intimately relatable to what we go through during our training. So if you haven't read it already, it's a really, really great book to read by a psychologist who was in the teaching space of teaching consultants how to teach, but then transitioned into more career counseling and psychological counseling. This is a basic assumption I have of everyone. I believe that everyone here is intelligent, capable, cares about doing the best and wants to improve. So, you know, I'm going to pick on people. I'm going to ask people questions, ask people for their answers. And sometimes you're going to say an absolutely amazing answer. Other times you're going to say an answer that isn't that great and you wish you could have said it differently. But just remember, no one cares. I don't care. This is about improving slowly. Multiple failures is what success is made out of. And I really want you guys to just embrace the fact that, you know, get all the stuff wrong, especially now, because it'll just, you know, it'll just make you better. So everything will be framed in that setting as well. So why is anesthesia challenging? Now, I think those of you who have already done a bit of anesthetics will realize that you've got a very short space of time in your early years. You work with a different consultant every day, and even every session. There's so many different opinions, and you can probably put your hands up now if you know you heard one consultant say this is definitely the way you need to do it. And another consultant the next day saying, oh yeah, you should definitely do it this way. We are so opinionated about stuff. And I often those things don't matter that much. And I'm going to acknowledge that completely. The thing is that most of the things that we don't disagree on, we don't even talk about. You know, if someone needs a tube, you put a tube in. 99.9% of the stuff is all agreed upon. But you'll be faced at the brunt of things that are often different opinions. And you only have 6 weeks or 3 months to really consolidate that. Often you have multiple tasks to recall and perform, and none of these are similar to the ward jobs you've had previously. And I think that's really obviously challenging as well. Also, anesthesia is one of those times where, you know, what I love about this specialty is that it's so accountable. You know, the time from action to disaster is very, very short. You know, it's in, you know, seconds to minutes to hours, whereas most other specialties, it's hours, days to weeks. So there's very little time for reflection and research and, you know, consulting Google. So your knowledge and skills are tested very, very quickly. Imagine every induction that you do when you start off. There's so many things going on. It's very hard to reproduce and practice that. So hopefully what I'll give you then is a really solid, robust framework to hang that knowledge on as you go through those first few weeks and even your later training. And also you've had probably very few anesthetic days, maybe 1 to 7 days in med school, and that's about it. Now, what I hate is the fact that at the end of your rotation, you may have then recognized the patterns and formed a routine, but that's at the end of your rotation. And you know, why not do it at the very start? So this course, this session is all about trying to get you that framework so that you don't have to have that aha moment at the end of your rotation, and hope you'll have lots of those moments on a solid framework from the very start. So what I can give you in this course, I want to give you the knowledge and skills from day one. I want to acknowledge that some people have done the anesthetic rotation, they're about to do it, or they're in, you know, within the anesthetic rotation. Again, it doesn't matter so much. It's very hard to time the course perfect for everyone, but just know that wherever you are, the course will give you something slightly different. And what I care about is the fact that you have all of these resources. Hopefully you've printed out your workbook or it's on your iPad, and you can always refer to that to train whatever skill you want to train that day. Maybe one day you're thinking about patient assessments, the next day you're thinking about airway assessments, and you've got a framework to hang all of that knowledge and all of those little bites of information on. So I want to give you that knowledge and skill and framework from day one. I want you to give you a standard approach to the start of your journey. I know a lot of consultants will have differing opinions to me, but just rest assured that this framework that you'll get is a very reasonable framework that not many people would consider controversial. So if you want to vary from a starting point, this is a pretty good starting point. I also want to give you an awareness of different consultant opinions at each step. So I may just offer that something's a gray area or something like that. And again, in the chat, if someone's told you something really different, please put it out there. I definitely want you to challenge me on stuff. I've got no ego about this. Plenty of times I get a good question and I learn from it as well. So please challenge me on anything in the chat. I'll definitely try to answer that or give the resources and references to do that. I also want to give you an awareness of the direction you should head to increase your independence and competence. And the example I give is like, say in the airway, the job of you as a resident is to give me the confidence to give you enough rope to get the experience that you deserve. So what I hope to do in this course is give you a lot of these knowledge elements. You know, anesthesia is a very technical based profession. It's a lot of skills. And obviously I can't teach you those skills of intubation, but what I can teach you is I can give you the chat and the talk so that as you're intubating, you know to talk about what you're seeing, that you can see the epiglottis, that now you're gonna ask for the bougie and burp, and maybe ask for a video laryngoscope. If you are talking through everything that I would do normally, then there's no reason for me to take that opportunity away from you. Whereas someone who's intubating who is silent, I don't know what you're thinking, and therefore I'm gonna intervene far quicker because you haven't earned the right to do the intubation, if that makes sense. So this whole session will be about giving you hopefully the confidence and the knowledge to then give your consultants confidence in you to give you enough rope for the experience that you deserve. That's your whole training game. I just think about this is what I did time and time again during my training. So I like to think that at the end of my training, I had so many more of those experience sets than other trainees may have done because I had that ability to, you know, just constantly talk about what I was doing to my consultants. So, keep going. The way I think about your early training, in the first 12 months, you might do about 500 cases if you're doing 12 months of full-time anesthesia. Occasionally, you'll have a real teaching moment And this course is about concentrating that experience. So let's drill the hardest parts of the introductory training, the hardest practical parts in this one session in one day. Again, it's a long day with lots of information, but why not do that? Because you can always review the stuff, even if you're a bit fatigued at the end, who cares, right? So high reps, focused training. I want your brain to turn from this into this. And that's what we're going to be about. By the end of your first rotation, with the knowledge and frameworks in this course, hopefully you get anesthesia, you have this faster learning curve, safer practice, increased ability, and then again, improve your chance of getting into whatever training program you need. So I've already sent people links to a talk about getting the most out of the rotation. I thought that I really want to focus, usually I run through this in this session, but what I thought we'd do is we'd actually just, you'd be able to watch that video and you can always email me any questions after watching those videos, which I'm really happy to answer. Again, the more questions you ask me, a lot of the material that I've created is just simply from questions that you ask me, and I really enjoy doing it. What else am I going to do in COVID, right? Please feel free to message with that. Throughout this session, I'll just put up QR codes. If anyone isn't aware how to use those, use your QR reader on your phone or use the camera on your phone, and that will set up a link if you just point your camera at this QR code. And I'll do that for various things throughout. That way you can just go to that video, bookmark it or whatever you need to do, and you can watch it at a later date. The way we're gonna organize this, I think the chronological approach is by far the best, because that just is exactly how you will end up in theater, in the hospital, as you're visiting your patient, making a plan. You'll do it all chronologically. So what we'll go is we'll go through a bit of anesthetic assessment, but the practical and harder elements of that, simple optimization steps, a perioperative risk benefit profile, the consent, some surgical issues to think about, a basic anesthetic plan, how to present the case to your consultant. Then we'll go, so that's all of the before theater tasks. We'll then go through the theater tasks, the pre-anesthesia checklist, how to decide on medications for your anesthetic, a basic induction, which I won't go through in too much detail, and then finally the extubation. That's all of the chronology of what you'll do in anesthesia. We'll go through all of that. Now, a lot of that might be quite straightforward for people who've done maybe, a full 6 months of anesthesia. But even if it is the stuff that you don't, I'll guarantee that a lot of the things that I'll talk about, maybe you haven't thought about and would be worthwhile with this exercise, doing the exercises anyway. After that, I've just tried to highlight the most high-end scenarios, which I thought are either taught very late in your piece or taught differently and just very high yield. So the patient with a cardiac issue for non-cardiac surgery, we'll go through airway management, crisis and problem solving, crisis resource management, and then critical anesthesia inductions.